digging up moles or worms. I don't know what he's doing, but he's digging up something. He's having a good time. Hey, look, I was filming a couple days ago on the final harvest, and I forgot to mention this, and I'd already turned off the cameras and put it away, and you'd gone home, and so I didn't feel like having everybody come by again, so I thought, well, I'll just bring it on the next episode. This is my pumpkin, the sugar pumpkin, to be precise. How cute is that? Just in time for Halloween. Yep, I planted these out on my neighbor's property, right off of my yard, because I thought, well, nobody's ever going to notice it growing there, and I didn't have any room here. And I mentioned this way back in the spring. And the vines grew, and they were doing good, and they were flowering. And then my neighbor brought his tractor by, and he mowed that unused land. And I thought, uh-oh, I can't tell him, don't mow my pumpkins. So I just watched as the pumpkins and vines went flying. He didn't even notice he hit them because he's on this big tractor. And I thought, oh, kind of sad, but you know, what do I expect? I was using somebody else's property, shouldn't have done that, but it was in the weeds. And he mowed them down, and I thought nothing of it. And then I think it was a couple weeks ago, I noticed, I was out at the edge of the yard, and I thought, wait a minute, there are some pumpkin leaves out there. And I saw these little green pumpkins. They were a little smaller than this, and they were, birds want out, you can hear them. Let us out, Daddy! So I let them stay as long as possible. When that frost hit, when I harvested, I had to harvest these because once the, you know, pumpkins hate frost. They hate it with a passion because of a lot of all the garden plants that I grow or that you've grown, pumpkins are a little bit different. Most plants have what I think, don't quote me on this, okay? Please don't quote me. I know you will. some people will. They're over on Wikipedia right now. But some plants have what I believe is called lignin. And it's some kind of a texture type fibrous thing in their leaves. And that's what holds the leaves up and makes the leaves stiff. Whereas pumpkin leaves, they rely on water pressure. It's kind of like those new kinds of swimming pools that people have. They're very inexpensive. You just fill it with air and everything. But they use water pressure to hold their leaves out. And that's why during the middle part of the day, you'll notice when it's really hot, your pumpkins will wilt. And you think, oh no, they need water. And you're pumping on the water. Well, they actually don't. That is a defense mechanism that the pumpkin uses. It releases the water pressure and the leaves wilt. That way there's less surface facing the sun, which means it takes less damage from the sun. Yeah, and in the evening, the leaves come right back up. Kind of cool. But anyway, the leaves got hit really bad by, I got birds in my garden. Ever since I took everything out of my garden, all these little sparrowette type things are over there eating all the seeds. But when the frost hit, No, leaves that depend on water pressure are very susceptible to frost. So they died. So now I have pumpkins that are half ripe. Hopefully, and I'm assuming if I put these in a window in my house, they're going to turn gold. They started to turn gold. I'm hoping they turn the rest of the way gold. I'm not going to carve these up for Halloween. No. These are my only two pumpkins, and I'm lucky to get them. I'm going to let them turn gold. These are sugar pumpkins, by the way. And the difference between a sugar pumpkin and a regular pumpkin is grown for looks and size, whereas a sugar pumpkin is grown for its flavor. Yeah, and these are sweeter by far than any pumpkin you'll ever eat, and they are exceptional for pies. Yeah, so these are wonderful. I'm going to save the seeds from these and grow them next year in my garden, not on a neighbor's property like I shouldn't have done to begin with, but I'm going to grow them in the garden and see how nice I can have my pumpkins, not how big, because I usually don't get that big. This is generally about the size they get, maybe a little bit bigger. They're not known for size, but they are known for flavor. And let me tell you something, when it comes to pumpkin pie, that is the way to go. So I'm gonna save the seeds from that. And today, I'm gonna be de-seeding all my beans. People have asked me, Ray, will you do a seed saving episode? Well, I've done seed saving episodes. And so if you look back, go to my video page on YouTube and just type in the search bar on my video page, seed saving, and it'll bring up a couple videos on how to save radish seeds, lettuce seeds, stuff like that from years ago. So I don't really feel a need to do that again, but I did save some cantaloupe seeds, and these are the ones that I thought were called Delice de la Table. They were from a little friend over in Idaho, and it turns out I don't believe they are Delice de la Table because I compared them to the ones on the internet and they didn't look like that, and he felt so bad. And I didn't mean for him to feel so bad, but I just wanted to make it clear to him that I can't mention something that isn't something. Otherwise, people jump on me about it and they're like, hey, you're wrong. And so I can't call these Delice de la Table because they're not, even though he thought that they were. They're some kind of heirloom cantaloupe, and they were so delicious. I actually sliced one open and I tasted it on camera, and you saw it. You saw it. Whatever these are, they are fantastic. So my little friend Hayden, who was so kind to send me these seeds, I'm going to call these little Haydens. So these are now called Haydens because we really don't know what they're called, so we can't give credit to whoever developed the seed. But since I grew them and they were given to me by a good friend in good faith, I'm going to call these my little Haydens. And I'm going to grow these, and I'm going to save seeds, and I'm going to share the seeds from now on, and they will be known as Hayden cantaloupes. So I wanted to do that for him. And also, I got some flack. Flack. Flack is crap, okay? That's a nice word for saying crap. Some people gave me crap for picking my wild cucumbers. I got some wild cucumbers growing on the other side of the property, and all a wild cucumber is, it's a vine that grows this weird little cucumber that has like little, they're sort of like hedgehog cucumbers, but not really. They have little spines on them, and they're totally unedible. And they're hollow, they look funky, and that's why I liked them. And they drop out four seeds, and they look like watermelon seeds. Take a look at these. How cool is that? Yeah. The reason I'm bringing this up is because it was really weird how it happened. I had one of these wild cucumbers, and I picked a whole bunch of them, and I put them in my little manly bucket, and I took them down into the basement because it's cool and dry, and I have a dehydrator down there amongst the mess. That's why I'm not showing the basement, because it's a mess. It's full of lumber and an air conditioner and all the projects I'm doing. I'm still working on a lot of stuff inside. But anyway, I took these downstairs, the cucumbers, and I set them down there. I thought, well, they'll dry, and then I'll crack them open and get the seeds. I had no idea what was going on. And one day I went down there, and they had opened up, and I showed a picture on my Facebook. It looked like an alien. Remember on Alien, the one with Sigourney Weaver, where she's running around in her tank top in all the episodes? Well, anyway, Sigourney Weaver taught us something. If you're ever in danger, run around in a tank top. That'll help. But anyway, the alien babies, they're in these eggs, and then when they're ready to hatch, they open up, and it's like these little lips that open up, and then this alien comes out and attaches itself to your face. Well, anyway, that's exactly what they look like, little alien babies. And then you take them and flip them upside down, and four seeds drop out, and they're already dried and ready to go. So that is cool. That is what I call cool. So I got this many seeds. I'm going to plant these around my property, and I might, may even grow one in the voodoo room. I mean, come on, how perfect is that for the voodoo room? So I may grow one in the voodoo garden and around this property, and eventually, once I get enough seeds, I'm going to start giving them away. Some people, the reason I got flack for this is because they're considered a noxious weed. And I figure a weed is just something that you don't want. I mean, if you don't want corn in your garden, it's a weed. If you're growing corn and you don't want a tomato, the tomato's a weed. All a weed is something that doesn't fit in with your plan of how to grow things. Well, these things have probably been around longer than humans, so as far as they're concerned, we're the weed. So I find beauty in them, I find function, I find a usefulness in them, so they're not a weed to me. If they inconvenience other people, well then fine. They can deal with it on their property. On my property, I'll do whatever I darn well please. And what I please is to grow these things. And if somebody wants to grow them, I'm going to share seeds with them. Also, look at me on my little soapbox. And today, though, is a day I wanted to sit out here before I let the chickens of war out. Because I wanted to be out here by myself with Rascal. And I'm going to be taking the bean seeds out of the pods. Remember, I picked these. And I got two containers of this. This is only one container. And I told you how to pick these and set them aside. Well, now they're dry. And listen. See? Yep. Well, I hope you heard that. You got him barking and them clucking and birds screaming and the farmer's starting to harvest his soybeans over there. So it's kind of busy around here today. But all you do is you crack these open, pop the dried seeds out because they've been drying for a couple weeks. I put them in a plastic container. I toss a lid on it. I label them and I throw them in the basement in a cool, dark place and they're fine all winter long. As far as storing seeds, any kind of seed, I think my opinion and my way of doing things is I do not put them in the refrigerator because a refrigerator can be a damp place. And you'll find this out if you ever put ice in your freezer and you notice that the ice is slowly getting smaller and smaller, it's evaporating. Yeah. You can actually have ice evaporate in a frozen environment. And whenever you put stuff in the fridge, you open up the door to the fridge and you close it, you're letting in moisture in the air and that moisture goes in there. So if you don't have your seeds in a very airtight container in that fridge, they're being exposed to moisture all the time, a cool, moist place. And I don't believe that that is my best bet. for my seeds, because I hold a lot of value in my seeds and I don't want them to have any kind of damage. But you can store them in the fridge if you want. I would suggest, if it was me suggesting it to you, I would say put them in an airtight container and throw them in the bottom of a closet if you don't have a basement. Throw them in a closet lower on the in the room, because the lower in the room it is, the cooler it is. So like say in the back of your closet, it's a dark, cool place, perfect place to store your seeds. It's not rocket science. I mean, seeds, they've been around longer than we have. So, they survive the environment out here. So really, don't overthink it. They're gonna be just fine. And I'm gonna be growing these next year, definitely next year. I'm gonna keep saving these. These are from my Landreth stringless green beans. The best tasting green bean I've had in my life. And when you're as old as me, you know, and you've been a gardener for so long, you've grown a lot of different beans. I've grown pole beans, I've grown bush beans, I've grown them all different types. And this is the best that I've ever found. And that what I like about them is the flavor. I like that they're profuse and everything about them. I like everything about them. So I'm gonna keep growing these year after year. And this is how I save the seeds from them. Very simple. I'm gonna show you how I save pepper seeds. Remember I told you I was gonna save seeds from those peppers. And I shot some footage and take a look at how I save pepper seeds and how I process the peppers to store them. Because people ask me, how do you process your peppers? I'm growing a lot of peppers. Well, let me show you how I do that, okay? Take a look at this.
The peppers I have are the Cubanelle. Normally the Cubanelle are a green color like this, like a lighter green, but when they get fully ripe, they start turning orange and then they eventually turn red. This is the final color for the Cubanelle, and generally a lot of peppers will turn red when they're fully ripe. This one is partially ripe. Now if you pick your peppers and they've already started to ripen, you can set them aside, not in a sunny window, out of direct sunlight, just set them out, and they will continue to ripen. If you're saving seeds, you want to make sure that your peppers are as ripe as possible, because that way the seeds have been given all the nutrients they need and they're as mature as they're going to get. This, for instance, is a Jimmy Nardello. Jimmy Nardellos start out green, a really beautiful dark green, aren't they? But they eventually start turning lighter colored, like an orangish color, and eventually they will turn red if allowed to ripen on the plant. If you pick them green, generally, it's hard to get them to turn red, but I had a frost, so I really have no choice. So I'm going to let these sit out and ripen as much as possible indoors before I take out the seeds. Hopefully, they'll start turning yellow and maybe orangish, and that might be ripe enough for them to have fully ripened seeds. This one here is, I can't pronounce it, I call it the giant canna google. It's a large sweet pepper, and I think this will turn orange when it's ripe. Not sure, but it was a medium to light green, but right on the top, on the shoulders, you can see it starting to turn a lighter color. Hopefully, this will turn a light orange or maybe a medium orange, and I'll be able to save seeds from that as well. But for right now, we do have one pepper, and this is how I save seeds. I take a knife and I slice off the cap, and you can do this any way you want to open up the pepper. And then I just slice it right down the center. Now right here, if you look really close, you're gonna see some mold. This is not a good thing. If you ever have darker colored seeds or mold, don't save that. Your seeds should look like this, a really nice color. So what I'm gonna do is cut out the entire area. This is called the pith or placenta. Now you can cut it out or you can take it out with your fingers. I'm gonna be honest with you, I don't ever use a knife. So you want to take this out, take the seeds off, and take all the best looking seeds. Take all the crappy ones and get them far away from the good ones. You want to make sure that you do not have anything that's going to make these seeds want to rot. And you can also dry this right on the pith, but I like to just remove them like that. And here we have the seeds. Very simple, wasn't it? Take the seeds, set them on a paper plate or a paper towel, and then put them in a cool, dry place, and they'll dry. You could put them in the window, like on a paper plate in your window, but make sure that you have ventilation, because that temperature in the window can roast these seeds. And when they get that hot, you know, like 140, 150 degrees in that window, it could kill the seeds. So the sunlight will help dry them out, but make sure that you have some kind of ventilation. Ventilation is the key. As soon as they're dry, they're going to look kind of a golden colored and kind of thinner and kind of puckered a little bit. You put them in a Ziploc baggie or any kind of airtight container. Store them in a cool, dark, dry place, preferably the basement. That would be fine, or your fridge if you don't have a basement, and they'll be just fine until next year. Now that we have seed saving out of the way, I'm going to show you how I preserve my peppers. It's very simple. I rinse them off first, and I take a sharp knife, slice off the cap, stick my finger in, pop out the pith or the placenta. I like to call it pith because, you know, talking about placenta along with food, it really kind of creeps me out. I just pop it out. There may be a couple seeds left. Go like that, pops them right out, and then I save the whole pepper, toss it in a bowl, throw the seeds and the pith away. And the reason I throw the seeds away is because these are not fully ripe peppers. We had a frost last night, so I had to pick all my peppers. So these I don't think are ripe enough to save seeds from. And by the way, I mentioned in saving seeds that you want to make sure that you get the ripest peppers. Now, if you save seeds, you take them out of a pepper and you dry them and they turn black. If they turn black after being dried, those seeds are not viable. Toss them away. They're not going to work. If you open up the pepper and they're black, they're rotted anyway. All right. Once we toss the pepper in there, we just pop the cap out of here. We got a little donut. Toss that in there as well. And if I'm going to save them in the freezer raw, all I'll do is I'll slice them in half this way and then chunk them. By chunk, I mean bite-sized pieces. And that's all I do. I toss them into a Ziploc baggie, a freezer bag, not any Ziploc baggie. Make sure it's freezer bags, because freezer bags are a lot more airtight and they're going to hold out the moisture that's in your freezer, and it's going to keep them from being freezer burned and drying out. So you want to make sure that you have chunks like this, toss them in a freezer bag, roll out all the air, and throw them in the freezer, and you're all set to go. That's all there is to saving peppers. Here are some peppers that I froze from my second harvest. Whenever you use them, just open them up, take a handful out, and they break apart very easily. You can throw them in your soups, stews, stir fries, scrambled eggs, anything you want to use, and they're going to have some texture to them. They're not going to be mushy. They're not going to be crispy like a fresh pepper, but they're not going to be as mushy as a canned pepper. And just open it up, take out what you need, seal the bag back up, squeeze the air out, back in the freezer it goes. And these will literally, if you have them in a good quality zipper lock freezer bag or an airtight container in the freezer, they'll last indefinitely. I don't know how long they'll last, but I've had them for years and they tasted every bit as fresh the second and third year as they did the first season. Now, when it comes to saving peppers, I like to save all of them all together. I don't separate them out like the giant canagules and then the nardellas and then whatever these little nodules are. I don't separate them out. I mix them all together. And by the way, these are all sweet grilling peppers, so there is no heat involved. Now, the reason I put them all together is because each one has their own individual flavor, and I like that those are all mixed up so that when I use my peppers, I have a variety of textures and a variety of flavors. Like for instance, these are the Cubanelles. They tend to have a thinner wall. See how thin the wall is on that? The flavor is mild, but it's distinctly Cubanelle. Now, when we go to the Jimmy Nardello, you can see that it has a thicker wall, and it also has a different flavor. Same thing with the giant canagules. They all, and you can use ripe ones, unripe ones, mix them all up for color and flavor. Oops, I didn't take that one apart yet. But that's how I save my peppers. Now another way, now by the way, if you get a few seeds in with them, don't worry about it. Seeds actually taste pretty good. Now, generally, when I'm harvesting my peppers at the end of the season, that's around the same time that I'm doing my last barbecue, because I love to cook out, so I'm barbecuing. Now what I do with these is I take this special rack, and this is really nothing special, I just got this at Walmart, has little holes in it, because you can't really throw your peppers on a grill. You can with the large ones, but the smaller ones, they're going to fall through the screen. So that's why this is so handy. You could just throw them out, you can break them up into pieces, but I just throw them on whole. Just throw them on there, get your grill nice and hot, and then set this whole grill right on your barbecue. Hit them with a little olive oil if you want. I don't hit them with olive oil at all. I just throw them on there, turn them every now and then, and they'll eventually soften up, and a lot of the moisture will leach out of them, and they'll toast up, and you'll get this beautiful flavor. And you cook them until they're just soft. Then you take them, throw them in a Ziploc baggie, freeze them just like I did with the raw ones, and you have even more flavor in your peppers, frozen and ready to go at any time.
Yep, it's just that simple. Yeah, I know. You look at my stuff and you go, well, I thought there'd be more to it than that. Well, no, there isn't. That's the thing, is that you can look around and you can research stuff, and I do get a lot of people that come to me and say, Ray, and you'll see this, I'm not just saying this, look on my Facebook, look on my comments section, people will actually start out with, I have spent a lot of time researching this and I am confused. That's generally how the conversation starts when people are asking me questions, and I understand that. The internet is full of information, and not all of it is accurate information. You don't have to be right to have something on the internet. You just have to have access to the internet. And so a lot of things that people post on there, they're just flat out not true. And they're also misinformation, and people also like to be a little complex about things, and that just tends to confuse things. I like to just keep it simple. So people come to me and they go, Ray, give us a straight out simple answer. Not all my answers are gonna work. Not all my answers are what you agree with, but my answers are something that I actually practice in my everyday life. So if I'm giving you an answer, it's the best possible answer I can give you, and it's something that works for me, and it's something I have confidence in. I'm not just trying to shine you on and give you something to shut you up and get you on your way. This is something that I hope will help you. So if I'm telling you how I'm saving seeds, you may not agree with it, you may not practice it, but this is exactly how I do things myself. So with that being said, I got to get back to work saving these bean seeds because I got to let the chickens out. And the reason the chickens aren't out right now is because you just know those curious little boogers are going to be over here knocking this over, eating that, eating this, pecking at this. What's that? Hey, Ray, can I sit on your lap? And they already damaged my, I don't even know what this thing is. It's some kind of flower somebody sent me a long time ago. On the episode in the Voodoo Garden, when somebody was moving to another country, they sent me their plants. Yeah. And I grew this in the Voodoo Garden, and it was a really nice tall thing with big tall leaves. And then I brought it out, I cut it down, and I took the bulb out, and I saved it. I put it in a cool, dark place, and I stored it like an onion, and then I moved here into Iowa, and then I decided, you know what, I don't want to grow this inside anymore. I want to grow it outside and see how it goes. And you saw in previous episodes this summer, I had this flower growing here with a big red flower. It has multiple flowers. They call it a Christmas something, not a Christmas cactus, some kind of Christmas lily of some sort, and I can't remember what it is right now, but it grew really well. And so what I'm going to do, instead of digging this bulb up, the chickens ate most of this and stomped on what was left. I'm going to put a thing of dried grass and some chicken wire over this to help protect it for the winter and see if it comes up in the spring. It's not supposed to work that way, but you know what? I really don't care. I think it might, because these things were grown in nature a long time before they were grown indoors. So I think there's a way to preserve them over the winter. So I'm going to give that a shot. Well, I hope you enjoyed today's episode. It was just me being out here having a good time, saving my seeds, talking to you a little bit. And I got some more stuff coming up. Actually, this is one of the last of, I said the last episode was the last gardening episode and harvest and everything, and it was. I'm just saving seeds. Next one, I need to either pick apples or I need to get that little Frady hole done up for the winter, get a door on there, or get my raised beds going. Not quite sure exactly what I'm gonna do, but whatever it is, we'll do it together. How's that sound? All right, I gotta get going. Thanks a lot for joining me. It's kind of cold today. Not as cold as the other day. My mouth is working today. But anyway, thanks for joining me here. I really do appreciate it. I'll talk to you soon. Bye. Rascal sitting in the sun. Rascal, come here. Say goodbye. Come on, hurry. Time's running out. If he had longer legs, he'd be here a lot quicker. Come on. He thinks I'm trying to trick him. Yeah, look at the little wet legs. Ew, you're all wet. I know. Normally when he's cold and wet like this, he'll sit on my lap, but I have beans on my lap, so no, I don't want him to do that. Okay, I think I should take him inside and warm him up. Anyway, we'll talk to you soon. Bye. Hey, you little compost eater. Let's go. I'll put you inside.